Hi, I'm Cathy with Level Up RN. In this video, we are going to talk about the IV route for medication administration. And at the end of the video, I'm going to give you guys a quiz, test your knowledge of some of the concepts I will be covering in this video. So definitely stay tuned for that. Let's start off by talking about best practices for IV insertion. In terms of catheter size, we're going to want to use a bigger catheter, so a smaller gauge, for trauma patients. So for trauma patients, we would use a 16 gauge catheter. If we're talking about a surgery patient, then an 18 gauge would be appropriate. And for medical patients, we can use a 20, 22, or 24 gauge catheter. When we are attempting insertion of an IV, we want to place the patient's arm in a dependent position to really encourage blood flow down into that arm. We would place a tourniquet about 5 to 6 inches above the insertion site, and we can use a blood pressure cuff instead of a tourniquet for older patients. You want to try using veins or inserting the catheter in a vein distally on the arm first. So you don't want to start up high, because if you mess up and blow out that vein, then you're not going to be able to use that vein down lower from that injury site. So you want to start lower on the patient's arm, and if you don't hit it, you can kind of work your way up. You want to avoid any like hardened veins, and we also want to avoid veins in the hand for older patients, because there's a lot of nerve endings there, so it can be really painful. And also those veins tend to be kind of wiggly and difficult to hit with an IV. You want to avoid veins in flexion areas as well, such as the anticubital fossa. So those veins there in the AC are pretty easy to see and to hit. And obviously, if we're dealing with an emergency situation, we want to get that IV in as fast as possible. So the AC would be appropriate in that case. But if we're talking about a stable patient who's going to be admitted to the hospital, then really it makes sense to choose a different area that is not in the AC or any flexion area. Because if you put the IV in there, then when the patient is like eating or doing other things, they're bending their arm, and that's gonna cause the IV to become occluded, and that's gonna cause the IV pump to start alarming, and you're gonna be in that patient's room every 2 minutes resetting the alarm until you really bite the bullet and like move their IV to a better spot. So it's just better to start off with a better spot than to put it in the AC and then have to move it later. You also never want to put an IV on the same side as the patient has had a mastectomy, or where a patient has an AV fistula, which they would use for dialysis. So in terms of inserting the catheter, you want to insert it at a 10 to 30 degree angle, and you need to use a new sterile needle for each insertion attempt. So if you're trying to insert the IV and you're not hitting it and it's not going well and you pull it out, you can't just stick it back into another spot. You need to go get another kit. So when I used to be a floor nurse, I don't do a lot of IV insertions now, but when I was a floor nurse, I would always bring 2 or 3 kits with me because I wasn't the best at IVs right out of the gate. So again, you need to use a new sterile needle for each insertion attempt. Once we've successfully inserted our IV line, we need to take measures to maintain the patency of that line. So if the patient is not getting continuous IV fluids through that line, then we're going to want to flush that line every 8 to 12 hours with normal saline or per facility policy in terms of the timing. And then every 24 hours, we're going to want to change all the IV tubing out. And anytime we connect a syringe or line to that IV access site, we want to scrub the port down with an alcohol swab for 15 seconds. And anytime we're giving medication, we always want to check the compatibility of that medication with the IV fluids that the patient is receiving. And then if the patient is getting TPN, so total parenteral nutrition, that TPN line is dedicated for just TPN. So we are not going to administer any kind of medication through that line. We need to use a separate line to give the patient their IV medication. And then we always want to flush before and after the administration of any IV medications. So when you come in the patient's room, you want to bring a couple of flushes along with the medication syringe. You want to attach one of the normal saline flushes to the port, and you want to aspirate and check for that blood return to make sure that the IV line is patent, that there's no clotting or other issues. Once you see that blood return, you can flush the line with the normal saline, disconnect that saline flush, attach the medication syringe, push the medication at the prescribed rate, disconnect that syringe, and then flush again with another normal saline syringe. So again, we're always flushing before and after medication administration. So peripheral IVs are fine for short-term use. However, if your patient requires long-term antibiotic therapy or chemotherapy or total parenteral nutrition, then they really need to have a central venous catheter or a CVC. There are several different types of CVCs out there, including tunneled and non-tunneled CVCs, as well as implantable ports and PICC lines. I actually had to have a CVC when I was pregnant because I had hyperemesis, which required me to get TPN, which in turn required me to have a CVC. So no matter the type of CVC that your patient has, the catheter tip will terminate in the superior vena cava right above the right atrium. And that vein there is nice and fat, and it's able to accommodate harsher medications such as vancomycin or chemotherapy, as opposed to your peripheral vein, which is kind of skinny and delicate and would not hold up well to a medication such as vancomycin over the long term or chemotherapy. So in terms of the nursing care of a CVC, 24 hours after your patient has the CVC inserted, you're going to want to do a complete dressing change over the insertion site using aseptic technique. And then going forward, you will need to perform dressing changes weekly or per facility policy, again, using aseptic technique. If you need to access your patient's implantable port, you need to do so using a non-coring Huber needle. And if you've never used this before, then definitely reach out to your mentor nurse or your charge nurse for help showing you how to do that the first time. Just like with peripheral IVs, we're going to need to flush our CVCs on a regular basis. And we would flush these with normal saline, or sometimes at certain facilities, they would flush using heparin. And we always want to flush with a 10 milliliter syringe or bigger. So if we use a smaller syringe, it puts too much pressure on that catheter. So you always want to use a bigger syringe, at least 10 milliliters or bigger. And then lastly, you never want to take blood pressure on a patient's arm where they have a PICC line. So you definitely want to make sure you use the other arm instead. Okay, it's quiz time. I have three true or false questions for you. Question number one, IVs should not be placed on the same side as a mastectomy or AV fistula. True or false? The answer is true. Second question, a PICC line should be flushed with a syringe that is smaller than 10 milliliters. True or false? The answer is false. We want to use a 10 milliliter or larger syringe when flushing our PICC line. Question number three, you should not give any medications through a line receiving TPN. True or false? The answer is true. Hopefully you found this video helpful as well as that quiz. If you did, be sure to like the video. Thank you so much for watching. I invite you to subscribe to our channel and share a link with your classmates and friends in nursing school. If you found value in this video, be sure to hit the like button and leave us a comment and let us know what you found particularly helpful.